I'm here at the National Corvette Museum in Bowling Green, Kentucky, about a half mile south of the assembly plant for the Corvette. Now I'm here to learn about solar cars. You probably knew that from the thumbnail. Let me spin this camera around. We've got some EV charging on site, brand new, just installed or updated equipment. Anyway, what I want to talk about is across the highway at NCM Motorsports Park. That's where student teams are competing in a solar event, actually two solar events. The first one is the Formula Sun Grand Prix. That's happening today and over the next 2 days afterwards. Following that, they'll be competing in a road race from Nashville, Tennessee, all the way to Casper, Wyoming. If you're interested to check this out, go to americansolarchallenge.org. Let's see what we can learn from the teams.
Events like this have lots of rules to ensure fairness and above all, safety. I'll put links to the rules in the notes. There are two classes of solar cars, single occupant and multi-occupant vehicles, which start to look like a car. In fact, the multi-occupant cars remind me of the Aptera electric car. You remember that, right? Still not in production. I'm still not a fan of the styling, but there are a lot of people eagerly awaiting this vehicle, and I do hope it happens. Teams submit numerous documents and presentations on their designs before even showing up. Batteries are limited by weight for a particular chemistry. Because of this, most single-occupant cars have about 5 kilowatt hours of storage. Multi-occupant cars can go above this. Solar cars are limited to their overall size. That limits the solar collection area, and the grade of solar cells used is also limited. Teams may only use commercially available silicon-based solar cells. More advanced cells used in satellites like gallium arsenide are not allowed. Single-occupant cars can collect up to about 1,000 watts or 1 kilowatt of power. Multi-occupant cars can collect a little more than that. However, multi-occupant cars can also recharge using a plug, just like an EV. This gets counted against them, but it does play into the strategy for their class. I spoke to Appalachian State about their two-seat car. The battery died on his mic, so that's my bad, but here's a highlight of our conversation.
So all of the MOBs have the ability to plug into a wall, just like any electric car you'd see on the road. It is a point deduction, so you ideally don't want to do this. I don't know what the cloudy weather is going to do, so it might force teams to do it anyway. But you are able to plug into a wall just like any other.
An electric motor provides the power. The most popular motor is from Mitsuba. Their representative was in from Japan. This was his first time in the U.S., and the students gave him a very warm welcome.
And now, here in U.S. also, many teams are using our motor. We are very happy about that. Yeah.
Now, I learned you were here from one of the universities. They said they had you sign their motor. Have you been doing that?
Yeah. Actually, I also very surprised, but they strongly requested them. They feel something. We are legend, but we are not a legend. Just we are doing standard things. What we can do? What we can provide. But they really love our product. So then they requested a sign. So I did a sign. Yeah.
Cars are required to have turn signals, brake lights, headlights, all that stuff. They need to be able to run in the dark if necessary. Safety requirements, visibility, a windshield wiper, and a rear view camera. Scrutineering is the make or break stage for these college students. Static testing looks over how their designs were implemented. Occupants of the solar car must be able to get out in less than 10 seconds if an emergency arises. Welded tubes are common for the chassis, but some teams have moved on to a more advanced, lighter monocoque design. But even then, a metal roll cage above the driver is required, as are seat belts. Rarely do teams fly through without any issues identified, and it often requires creativity and hard work to address them. Speaking of hard work, this is no day at the beach. Solar cars love the sun, but working in that hot sun can be brutal. Zero complaints from these students. They worked late, many opting to camp out on site to spend more time with their car and more money on them. The U-turn test starts off the dynamic portion of Scrutineering, measuring the turning radius of these vehicles. Teams like to tuck the front wheels behind aerodynamic skirts, but the car still needs to maneuver in a situation like this without backing up. After passing that, they can then proceed to the figure eight test. This ensures maneuverability, let's say in a traffic situation, so no knocking over the cones and no body rub conditions. That's something they're looking for in this test. Turning to the left and to the right, solar cars must be able to reach a speed where they can complete each side of the figure eight in less than 8 seconds. Braking test is conducted under wet conditions. The car must achieve a minimum speed of 25 miles per hour, measured by a radar gun. You'll hear one of the course workers shouting out the approaching speed. 25. The car must stop in a minimum amount of time based on the speed that they're coming in with and under control. Once they pass, additional drivers need to replicate this to make sure they're all capable of operating the brakes safely. The slalom test, teams must be able to navigate this in 11 and a half seconds or less. Given the length, that works out to about an average of 25 miles per hour over the duration. Here's the two-passenger car from Iowa State, and at the end of the slalom, you can hear the right rear wheel brake and the car come to a skidding stop. Fortunately, they were able to make repairs in the evening and went on to compete on the track. Teams who make it through Scrutineering can compete in the Formula Sun Grand Prix run on the Motorsports Park, which is over 3 miles in length, featuring elevation changes and, honestly, some very pretty scenery. When the flag drops on day one, not all teams had yet passed Scrutineering. That's not uncommon. And some teams opted to skip the green flag to make some last-minute changes or to charge their vehicles in the sun. Seth Windrob from the title sponsor Electrek was there to drop the green flag, and the cars took off. One favorite question people ask of all these teams is how fast these cars can go. And the answer is often quite frightening. I interrupted dinner for the University of Michigan to ask that question.
Yeah, so this car can go up to 85 miles an hour. We are limited by the tires, actually. So theoretically, the car could go faster. In testing, we were driving, you know, somewhere around like 85 on a track just to see like how our car was performing, how much energy we were consuming.
I'll publish a full video of my conversation with Michigan later. Top speed for these cars is not relevant. Speeds in the 30 to 35 mile per hour range are much, much more efficient for the cars and safely achievable. When passing, cars are required to sound their horn long and loud so that the other car can hear them. Breakdowns do happen on the track. That's when support vehicles drive team members out to try and get them going again. On the following days, more cars passed Scrutineering and began to accumulate laps. For single-occupant cars, the scoring is easy. More laps, more better. Multi-occupant cars have a formula that factors in the number of passengers in the vehicle, the amount of external energy used, remember you can plug them in, and the speed they maintain. Two-passenger is the most common multi-occupant vehicle, although Georgia Tech put together a four-passenger design. Here's a chart comparing the various multi-occupant vehicles. Single-occupant vehicles have their battery impounded each night, so it gets taken out to make sure there's no external charging happening. Multi-occupant vehicles do the same, but they're also metered to record how much external energy is being added if the team chooses to do so. The track features a section called the sinkhole, and it looks fun. Drivers apparently, though, needed to get used to the steep downhill followed by an uphill section. Maybe fun isn't the right word that they would use. As for Formula Sun, the event progressed on, more teams passed Scrutineering, leaders emerged in the standings, and some went on to qualify for the American Solar Challenge. That's the event that takes place from Nashville to Casper, Wyoming. Teams need to demonstrate on the track that they can achieve enough miles in a given day or over consecutive days to go on to that road event. So there you have it, an overview of the events, a peek at the cars, A full list of participants is available at americansolarchallenge.org. If the school you attended or the school you're a fan of have a solar car program, they're all looking for donations. So go ahead to the site. You can click on the links. It'll take you to the team website. Congratulations to all the students. Among them are undoubtedly some of the future stars of the electric vehicle industry.